morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Glad to have you with us. Good morning, everybody on Facebook that's watching or who will watch. Man, what a nice day compared to last night. Did anybody notice the wind blowing last night at all?
Yeah.
We didn't have power from 9 o'clock till like 2 o'clock this morning. So, yeah, it was whipping and screaming and yowling and howling and all that stuff. But, you know, there's always a storm before something good. Have you ever noticed that in your own life? There's always some kind of damage or there's some kind of wind going on or some kind of storm blowing that you know God's working something out in your life because it's really bad and then all of a sudden there he is. But he was in the storm too, right? And as we remember the story about Elijah, God wasn't in the thunder, he wasn't in the wind, he was in the still small voice that we hear that gives us hope and helps us to realize that no matter what's going on in our lives, God's there with us. So we're going to pray and invite him to be the most important part of what we're doing today, because if we've come here today with any other intention than to be in God's presence and to be touched by him, we're here for the wrong reason. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you want to be with us and you want us to be with you. We thank you that you loved us so much that you sent Jesus to give his life for us. And before he could do that, though, he had to be born into this world. And we're right fat in the fat part of the Christmas season. And Father, I pray that as you speak to our hearts and talk to people around the world, as your Holy Spirit speaks to them, that they would remember it's not about what's on the shelf or not being able to get that toy that your kid wants. It's all about you. It's all about your love. It's all about your grace and all about your mercy that was displayed when Jesus was born and as he lived his life and then as he ultimately gave up his life so that we could understand who you are and that we could have our sins forgiven. Lord, you give us hope in the hopeless days. You give us joy when our hearts are broken. You give us peace in the midst of the storm. And you give us hope when it seems like everything around us is falling apart. And Lord, today I pray that you would be honored, that you would be glorified, that you would be in the center of everything that we do. And Lord, I pray that somebody in this room would walk out a different person because of what they've learned about you, because of what your Holy Spirit's done in their life, and because they've been willing to hear and to surrender to your will. In Jesus' name I pray.
Good morning, everyone. As I think about things that happened this week, I know that God's not dead. I woke up early one morning thinking about lots of things, not knowing how it was all going to get done. By the end of the day, it had all come together, and I even had an opportunity to pray with a coworker. By the end of the week, most everything was done. It truly was God, because it was nothing that I had done. Just like Jesus spoke to the disciples in the boat in Matthew 14:27, that Jesus spoke to them and said, "Don't be afraid, take courage, I'm here."
All right, let's stand together and sing. God's not dead. Does anybody believe that?
Yeah.
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 Let love is flowing, bring the dead to life. Love so bold to see a revolution somehow. Let love is flowing, bring the dead to life. So bold to bring a revolution somehow. Now I'm lost in your freedom, and this world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, surely alive, living on the inside, roaring like a lion. He's roaring, he's roaring, he's roaring like a lion. The stars can make the darkness hide. My faith is dead, I need a resurrection somehow. Now I'm lost in you. he's surely alive. Living on the inside, growing like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. Living on the inside, growing like a lion. He's roaring, he's roaring like a lion.
Shepherds catch their watching.
came as the King of the Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he was born to a young teenage girl, older teenager, and a man who was not his earthly father, but chose to follow God's rules and God's desire for him to raise Jesus. And, you know, we think about Jesus, and they said, you'll name him Jesus, but he'll also be Emmanuel. Jesus means Savior. Emmanuel means God with us. Jesus is what he does. Emmanuel is who he is. And we praise him for that. And the next song that we're going to sing is called Agnus Dei. It's Latin for praise God. And we're going to praise God this morning. Says that all of heaven sings that song in front of God's throne. Isn't that amazing? We're practicing for heaven. How about that? All right, everybody have a seat.
Desire of those religious leaders was to ruin Jesus' credibility. That was what they were there for.
They wanted to make him look bad. They wanted to come up with a way where they could make him look like a blasphemer, where they could make him look like a heretic, because that way they could tell the people you can't follow him because he's against God. But what's Jesus done? He's healed people. He's driven out demons. He's taught them about God's love and God's grace and God's mercy. And how can you find somebody who's doing all those really, really amazing good things and make them look bad? Well, you try to get them to say something, and then, I mean, just watch the news. Have you ever seen some of the little sound bites that they're able to cut out of an hour and a half long talk, and they get a 10-second or 15-second sound bite that makes somebody look like they said something exactly the opposite of what they really said? See it all the time, don't you? See it all the time. They were trying to get Jesus to say something that they could say, and use their quotes. He said, quote, right, blah, 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 which makes him a heretic. And they couldn't do it. And they were very frustrated because these were smart people. These were not a bunch of dummies that Jesus was dealing with. In order to be a Pharisee, you had to memorize Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Think about that. I don't mean the order. I don't mean those five names. I mean, you had to know those five books to be a Pharisee. Think about that with me for a minute. I talk to you guys all the time about find a life verse. One, just a verse, just memorize a verse, just one. And we're like, okay, do that. I don't have time. My mind just doesn't work like that. These people were actually religious lawyers. And what do you know about lawyers? Lawyers know loopholes, don't they? They'll follow it as long as it's good for them, but as soon as they want to change it to make it not good for them or good for somebody, not good for somebody else, they'll throw a loophole in there. And so, as we think about it, they want Jesus to look like a big old country bumpkin dummy. He came from Nazareth, and if you remember the story when Jesus was calling his disciples, and Philip went up to Nathanael and said, "We found the Messiah. He comes from Nazareth." And Nathanael's answer was, "Nothing good comes from Nazareth." You know, it's kind of like around here, every little town's got its own joke about the next little town. You ever heard some of that? My dad used to call my mom a stump jumper because she was from Kaiser. Right? And he was from Pennsylvania. And he couldn't be a hillbilly because they were Hill Williams in Pennsylvania and they were stump jumpers in West Virginia. So everybody, every town, the old town's probably got something to say about Flintstone. And Cumberland's got something to say about everybody else. That's just the way it is. And they were trying to make Jesus look like he was untrained because he hadn't been to one of the local seminaries, the schools that they taught all this stuff in. He was just self-taught. But you know what? Here's the amazing thing. He wasn't self-taught. He knew it. Why? Because he's God. He's God in their presence, and they're missing it, and they're trying to outsmart God. Think about that with me for a minute. How many people in the world try to outsmart God? Just about everybody at some point or another in their life. They're trying to be their own lawyer against God. Well, God, you know, I'm not as bad as Brian. He did that. Not only did this, you must know. Get him, don't just leave me be, right? And we do those kind of things. But as we look at Jesus, one of the things I notice as I'm reading through these stories, Jesus never has to stop and think about what he's going to say, does he? Does he? He has a response immediately when somebody's about to go against him. And the reality is that he's making them look like fools as their efforts continue to fail. In other words, he's flipped the script. He's making them look like dummies, even though they're the experts. They know it. And they know how smart they are. And they're proud of how smart they are. And Jesus just keeps flipping it back on them, so that they have to look and say, well, what do we do now? What do we do next? We've got to come up with something new. That didn't work. Wow, man, what are we going to do? We've got to get rid of this guy. Somehow or another, we've got to get rid of this guy. He flipped over the tables in the temple. He cursed the fig tree to make an example of what it looks like to be a hypocrite, if you remember that. He came in. People proclaimed him as the king. They didn't want that. They did not want that at all, because Jesus is very, very popular. He is at the very height of his popularity right now. The height of his popularity. And when would be the best time to try to ruin somebody? When they're on the way to the top or when they get to the top? Well, you try on the way, it's better to get them when they're at the top. Then everybody's looking when it happens. And that's what they're hoping to do. The chief priests and scribes and elders took their shot, and it didn't work. So let's look at Mark 12, 13 through 17, and we're going to expose flattery as hypocrisy. Mark chapter 12, starting in verse 13. Later, the leaders sent some Pharisees and supporters of Herod to trap Jesus into saying something for which he could be arrested. You see, that now it's out in the open. I mean, it's right there in the open. They're not even pretending anymore. But watch what happens here. Watch how they go about it. Teacher, they said, we know how honest you are. You are impartial and you don't play favorites. You teach the way of God truthfully. Now tell us, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or shouldn't we? They came at Jesus with flattery. To call him teacher is to call him rabbi, is to call him their peer. Their peer. Now, did they see Jesus as a peer? No, they did not. They saw him as something less than, lower than who they were. But they called him teacher. And then they said, we know how honest you are. How did they know how honest he was? Because they knew how dishonest they were. Isn't that a comparison that somebody would make of themselves? They knew how dishonest they were. They just wouldn't admit it, but they knew how honest he was because they couldn't catch him in anything. And an honest person tells the same story all the time so they don't have to remember the last lie they told. And that's where most people get caught is they forgot what lie they told this guy, so they told somebody else something, and those two get together. Well, he didn't tell me that. He told me this. And that's where the lie is exposed. But they're trying to butter Jesus up. They're trying to get next to his ego just a little bit. Here's something I want to tell you. When the Bible says that Jesus humbled himself, he didn't have an ego. He didn't have an ego. He humbled himself. He took on human flesh. He became like us to show us how we should deal with situations like he's dealing with. Think about that for a minute. I mean, have you ever had somebody come up and start talking to you, and you're already formulating in your mind what you're going to say to them, and the hackles on the back of your neck are standing up, and your shoulders are bunching up a little bit, and the veins in your neck are just starting to get a little bigger and a little bigger and a little bigger, and you're about to let loose all of heaven's fury right on you? Have you ever gotten that point where you just got so agitated with somebody that you just had to bite your tongue and keep it in? Jesus never had that problem. He didn't. He didn't. And he knew when they came up and buttered him up that they were trying to get him to do something they wanted him to do. And here's the amazing thing. He never, ever gives in. Never, not once does he give in. He never says, you got me now. Never does. And as we look at this, they tried to trick him into saying something so that it could be used against him. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to get him to speak against Rome. Because anybody who spoke against Rome became an enemy of Rome, and they could go to Pontius Pilate and they could say, hey, this guy's over here starting a rebellion. He's trying to talk about you. He says we shouldn't pay taxes. Well, that happened in the United States in about 1775. If anybody remembers the history, England was putting all kinds of taxes, the Intolerable Acts and the Stamp Act, and then they put a tax on tea. Well, back then, everybody didn't drink mocha, latte, frappe, yuccachino, whatever the rest of the name, mochiato, or whatever they call them. They didn't drink that. They drank tea because they were predominantly from where? England. Even though they were here in America and they'd been in America for a long time, they still had English habits and they drank tea. And they put taxes on the tea. And what did they do? 34 guys dressed up so nobody could recognize who they were. And they went on these ships and they took the tea. And it took them about 4 hours to dump it all in the bay of Boston. Thinking about that. What do we call it? The Boston Tea Party. Well, I don't think if people were going to have a tea party, that's what you would call a party. But they were having fun. And they dumped it because they weren't going to pay the king's taxes. And that was one of the ways that this country decided that it was going to separate itself from tyranny. And so what's going on here is these Pharisees, the followers of Herod, who was the king at that time, Herod Agrippa, one of the four tetrarchs that was in charge of Palestine, they were trying to get Jesus to quote-unquote sin against Rome or deny Rome or rebel against Rome. They knew they didn't have a leg to stand on. So they were trying to get him to get in trouble with Rome because Rome would take care of what they couldn't take care of themselves. Well, Jesus had an answer for them. They said, should we pay taxes or shouldn't we? Jesus saw through their hypocrisy and said, why are you trying to trap me? Now he's openly not just putting it back on him. He says, you're trying to get me to say something so that you can use it against me. Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that? And you know what? When you confront a bully and you ask them why, they usually do what? They don't have an answer. They don't want to answer. They don't want to. And these people are trying to bully Jesus. They're trying to make him say something they want him to say so they can get rid of him. Gone. Never be heard from again. Why are you trying to trap me? Show me a Roman coin and I'll tell you. When they handed it to him, he asked, whose picture and name stamped on this coin? Caesar's, they replied. Well then, Jesus said, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to you. And his reply completely amazes them. He sees through their ruse, and he turns the trap on them. So I could say the same thing today, couldn't I? Give to Caesar what is Caesar's. And that would be whatever the United States government takes out of your paycheck before you ever see it. And we don't have any control over that right now, do we? They just take it. They take it before you even get a paycheck. Have you ever talked to a teenager that just got their first job and they think, oh, they're going to pay me $10 an hour, and I work 10 hours this week, and I'm going to get $100, and they get their paycheck, and it's like, oh, somebody lied to me. Somebody robbed me in my paycheck. Think about that. Now, what do you do? Go down and knock on the door on Pennsylvania Avenue and say, I want my money back. Do you do that? No, because you're not getting through the gate. You're not getting close. But God requires that we owe him something too as an act of worship, doesn't he? God wants us to give him his first. Well, if you get paid first and the government takes theirs first, do you give God what's left, a percentage of what's left after the government gets their part? No. Because God gave you the ability to earn it all and it's his first. Pastor Ron's talking about money and it's Christmas time. Don't you know I've got presents to buy? Don't you know? Don't you know? Don't you know? Well, Jesus said you give to the government what you owe the government in taxes. And you give to God what's God's. Guess what? It's all God's. That's exactly right. It's all God's. It's all God's. He just lets you use it. And if you don't use it for his glory and his honor, what does he do? He makes it so you might not be able to have some more to use in the first place. Correct? So Jesus, it says they're astonished or amazed by what he says. Give me the coin. Let me look at it for a second. Because see, they had special coins that they paid the temple tax for. And then they had Roman coins, which they conducted business with. And he took that Roman coin, he said, who is that on there? What's his name? Caesar. He makes the money. He makes the rules. You pay him what you owe. And then you give God what you owe. You see, if he just said, no, we don't pay taxes because we don't recognize government. We don't recognize that those people have the right over us because they're pagans and this is God's land and we're only going to do what God wants the way God wants, they could have immediately sent somebody running to get the guard and they would come got him. They're trying to trap him. And Jesus calls them out on it. Instead of just giving them an answer back, he says, why are you trying to trap me? Why? You know, I would love for somebody who's being interviewed on TV by somebody who has an agenda to look at that person and say, what are you trying to accomplish by doing this? What's your purpose? What's your real agenda? Their real agenda is to try to get somebody to slip up and say something they can use in a 15-second soundbite, correct? But if you made them tell you what their agenda was, what would they do? Oh, we're just trying to find the truth. Oh, they wouldn't know the truth if it came up bit them in the butt. And yes, I did just say that. They wouldn't. they wouldn't know the truth if it came out bitter. And Jesus was kind of doing that to the Pharisees. You already know. We got to pay the tax. We got to. No option. It's part of being a citizen. Because, you know, guys, whether or not we believe that we're being taxed correctly in the United States, it still pays for us to have safety here. It funds our government. It funds our soldiers. It gives us roads to drive on. And make sure that we have law, police officers and things like that. Now, should we stand up when those kind of things start getting defunded and our money starts giving places other than where it should be? Yes, we have the right to complain about that. We do. We have the right to hold our government accountable for what they spend. Because there's no such thing as free money. Is there?
No.
And you tell me how much sense this makes. We borrow money from China so we can give it to people who don't want to work, and then we have to pay the interest on it, and who pays the bill? We do. Now, Jesus could have used all of those examples. But back then, there was no welfare. There was no, if you don't work, we'll pay you. It's if you don't work, you don't eat. Jesus wasn't dealing with all that stuff. He was dealing with some religious people who were specifically trying to get him to commit crime against the government by saying that Caesar did not deserve the tax money that they collected. Now, if you also know something about what was going on back then, most of the tax collectors in Palestine were Jews who sold their souls to the Roman government and who were allowed to keep a portion of what they collected, so they collected what Rome wanted, plus they kept their own to themselves. That's why it's so amazing that when Matthew starts following Jesus, Jesus looks at him and says, come on, follow me. It says he left it all and walked away to follow Jesus. He had a pretty lucrative business going on, I'm sure. But he left it all to follow Jesus. And as we think about that, there's somebody out there who's going to ask you a question, who's going to try to trip you up as you talk to them about who Jesus is and what he means in your life. There's always somebody that's going to have a straw man question. There's always going to be somebody who has one of those questions that nobody can answer, so that they throw it out at you, and they try to get you to say something that they could use against you. Well, I thought you were a Christian, or I thought you, well, you know, this or that, something else, when they do that kind of stuff. It's not up to you to answer their questions. It's up to them to prove that what you believe is wrong. And so as we think about that, God's given us the ability to understand by watching Jesus' example how to deal with people. He didn't start a fight. He just answered them, didn't he? And when he answered them, they automatically became speechless. They didn't know which direction to go with the next question. Okay? Now, if we look at the next section here, his cleverness amazed them. I wrote it down in the notes. It's kind of like the coyote chasing after the roadrunner. Have you ever seen the old roadrunner cartoons? The coyote knows right where the roadrunner is going to come running through. He draws a little map. He knows where the bomb's going to be. He pulls the string up to where it's going to be. And the plunger's sticking out of it. And he doesn't realize that he's pulling the plunger along with him and the box that sets the bomb off, that the bomb is following him and it didn't stay where it was supposed to be. He goes in the cave. And when he gets in the cave, he pushes the button and kablooey! And the roadrunner goes, beep, beep, whoosh, gone. Right? So it's kind of like Pharisees trying to catch Jesus in something that's going to cause him to stumble. He's not going to stumble. Now, we're going to have a resurrection riddle. Why would we have a resurrection riddle at Christmas time? Because Jesus being born was a pretty amazing thing. But him resurrecting from the grave is the most amazing thing. Defeating death and hell and the grave, so that we could have hope. But there was a group of people that were part of the Sanhedrin, a part of those religious people. We talked about the Pharisees. And then there was another group called the Sadducees. All right? Then there were the scribes and the lawyers. All those people, and the priests and the Levites, they were all part of this religious group that were trying to get Jesus to fail. And in verses 18 through 23, the Sadducees, the Jewish leaders who denied the supernatural, pose a question to Jesus. They didn't believe in anything supernatural. They didn't believe in any of the miracles that Jesus did. They didn't believe there were miracles. They didn't believe that Lazarus was raised from the dead because they didn't believe in the resurrection. They were a group of people who just went through by their head knowledge of what they knew, and they never let anything touch them, and they didn't believe that there was anything supernatural. They didn't believe in the devil. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in any of that kind of stuff. But they still called themselves followers of God. There's people out there today in the world who don't believe in devils and angels, and they still believe, they still call themselves followers of God. You can't be. Because God talks about all of it. And if you deny any part of it, it denies the existence of your relationship with God. Well, let's look at this for a second. Then Jesus was approached by some Sadducees, religious leaders who say there is no resurrection. That's why they're sad, you see. They don't have any hope beyond this life. So they're Sadducees because they don't believe in the resurrection, and that's why they're sad, you see. Old joke. They posed this question. Teacher, Moses gave us a law that if a man dies, leaving a wife without children, his brother should marry the widow and have a child who will carry on the brother's name. Well, suppose there were seven brothers. There's where we go. Well, suppose. What are we automatically moving into now? Hypotheticals. Do you know that every time you do a hypothetical, it has a chance of working? But in reality, they usually don't work. Correct? That's why science has so many hypotheses. I guess the hypotheses for science keeps changing about every 2 or 3 days in our world today. What would you say? The hypothesis isn't working, it keeps changing. But they're giving Jesus a hypothetical. Again, what are they trying to do? They're trying to give him a riddle or a quiz or a trap. They're setting him up. They're giving him the info so that he'll give the answer that would cause him now not to blaspheme against Rome, but to blaspheme against Moses, who is probably the most important person in the lives of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, because even when they celebrate the Passover, they leave an open seat for Moses. Think about that for a minute. They're trying to get him to speak against the one who gave the law. Suppose there were seven brothers. The oldest one married and died without children, so the second brother married the widow, but he also died without children, and the third brother married her. This continued with all seven of them, and still there were no children. Last of all, the woman also died. So tell us, whose wife will she be in the resurrection? For all seven were married to her. I'm thinking if I'm brother number 3 or 4, I'm going to start having somebody else take a sip of my tea before I take a sip of my tea. I'm going to get a food taster. How about you? I mean, we're talking black widow here. Seven men. All the men died. The woman's still alive. Look for fang marks on their neck. What in the world is going on here? You see how ridiculous the question is? It's absolutely ridiculous. Jesus, we're just going to ask you. Well, there's seven of them. Who's she going to be married to in the resurrection? Here's the problem. They don't even believe in the resurrection. They don't even believe in the resurrection. But they're asking Jesus a question about the resurrection. So if he answers, he's automatically going to be a dummy in their eyes. And if he says something against the law of Moses, he's automatically going to be, again, a blasphemer against those who are very important as far as the religion goes. They deny the resurrection while tying it to a brother-in-law marriage, dictates of Moses. And if you want to read that, it's in Deuteronomy 25, 5 through 10. You can go back and read that story. They pulled some obscure thing out of the Old Testament to try to make Jesus answer wrong, answer incorrectly. And they are mostly, let me give you a little history about the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They're a small sect of priestly families. They're wealthy aristocrats with significant political temple influences, dominated the Sanhedrin. They were the more important part of the Sanhedrin. They were the ones who were picked from to get the next priest. Okay? But they were the aristocracy or the elites of the day. Have you ever heard somebody who's an elite in our country talk about anything that has to do with God or the Bible or Christianity? I find it very fascinating that 98% of the time what they say is absolutely incorrect. It's either based in superstition or it's based in what Hollywood says. You know, they want the little drummer boy to be there. The little drummer boy wasn't there. That's why we don't sing pa-rum-pa-pum-pum at Cumberland Community Church. You know? They want Jesus to be quiet. That's why we don't sing, away the manger, no crib for a bed. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. He was a regular kid. He cried and pooped in his pants. He was human. But when you hear the elitists talk, they talk about stuff they know nothing of when it comes to a relationship with God. And how could somebody who's part of the priestly class not believe in what the Bible says? Because if you remember, one of the prophets raised a little boy who died, brought him back to life. That's resurrection, isn't it? Sure it is. And as they were carrying a guy along, he fell into a hole where Elisha's bones were laid, and he popped back up out of the grave alive. That's resurrection, isn't it? Here's the amazing thing. For religious people, you can show them the truth right out of Scripture, and it still is beyond their capacity to understand or accept. And Jesus is going to talk to them here and straighten them out in just a second. A little bit more about these folks. They're sympathetic to Hellenism or the Greek society. Well, the Greek society believed in multiple gods. They weren't all about religion and Judaism. They were about living their life in the world. They were cultural Jews. And do you know the amazing thing about the Jewish world today? Probably 90% of the people who are Jewish, who are born to Jewish families, they are cultural Jews. They don't believe the truths of Scripture. They don't follow the Ten Commandments. They're pro-abortion. They're pro all the liberal stuff. They're very liberal. Very, very liberal. And as we think about it and look at it, it's in our world everywhere we look. In Christianity, there are some folks who call themselves Christians who are absolutely liberal. And there are others who are very conservative. And then there are those in the middle who believe what the Bible says, and they just do their best to live by what the Bible says. And isn't that where we ought to be? Shouldn't we be living by what the Bible says? Shouldn't we believe what the Bible says? Well, I'm going home. Shouldn't we believe what the Bible says?
Yes.
Yes, because it's God's Word. Whether somebody believes it or not, it's God's Word. And these Sadducees considered only the books of Moses as authoritative, making them theological conservatives. They didn't believe in the Psalms and the Proverbs and the Prophets. They only believed in the first five books, and they stopped there. They didn't want to hear all the other aspects of God. They just knew that Moses said, and Moses wrote, and Moses did. So they're really not followers of God, but followers of the cult of Moses. It's just like in any other group. You know, you have people in the Catholic Church that call themselves Mariists. Do you know what a Mariist is? It's somebody who only worships and follows and prays through Mary to get things done. And that's the way it works. You can't just pick and choose part of God's Word. You need the whole counsel of God's Scripture, don't you? How else would we know about the birth of Jesus? 300 prophecies were fulfilled just in His birth. 300. Just in His birth by one person. And all those prophecies started back in Genesis. Genesis 3:15 is the first prophecy of Jesus coming to the earth. It doesn't mention Him. But it says the seed of woman will crush the head of Satan. And what did Jesus do on the cross? He crushed the head of Satan. Satan's still alive. He's still doing what he's doing. But he was defeated. And as we think about it, these people also had a strong doctrine of human free will. They wanted to do what they wanted to do, and they didn't think there was anything to pay for it. They didn't believe in angels or demons, or the immortality of the soul, or the resurrection. And they were not looking for a Messiah. Think about all those things. So if they didn't think Jesus was the Messiah, and they didn't think He was the King, and they didn't think He was from David's line, why in the world would they be giving Him so much grief? Why would they do that? Because when you get religious people together, everybody plays. They all have to have their pet peeve answered. They have to have their pet answer taken care of. And one of the things that I hate to deal with, and I know Jesus was laughing to himself. He had to be. It doesn't say it in the Scripture, in my opinion. He had to be laughing to himself when they asked him this question. because they made it such an elaborate question, an elaborate ruse. How many of you in this world today, if your sister-in-law, man, died, you would be willing to take her on as a wife and have a kid with her in your brother's name? How many of you ladies, if your husband died, would like your brother-in-law to come and be your new husband and have a kid in your husband's name? I mean, this is so far removed from what we have in our society today, from what we understand. But a comment was made to Michael the other day, you better hurry up and get married and have kids because you're the last one carrying the Yost name. Well, how much does that matter in the world anymore? You know, a lot of young people are adopting to not have, they're not having kids. They're having puppies. And they're having kitties. And hamsters and fish. They don't want kids. Because a lot of them in the world today have come up with a bad understanding of what it means to be in a family where the marriage is no good. And as we think about it, there used to be a time when people worried about their lineage running out. And, you know, we have people who can look all the way back. I mean, his name was Astor, but I'm a relative of John Jacob George Peter Paul Astor, the guy who financed the Titanic. He was my grandfather's some number of cousins removed. And John Astor, the guy that started the fur trade in the United States, in Canada, is one of my relatives. And Meshach Browning, who was around and was the Daniel Boone of his day, is part of my lineage. But none of them have my name, and one of them comes from my grandma's side, and one of them comes from her grandma's side, and one of them comes from my dad's side. So, you know, when we look back at all that stuff, it's great to look back and see all those people who were famous before you got here. Until you figure out you're not nearly as famous as they were, and you're not going to be. Kind of a letdown, isn't it? But they wanted Jesus to say that she was going to be married to all of them in heaven. Because they were all married in heaven, or on earth. But polygamy was not permitted at that point in time, and it's not permitted today in the civilized world. It happens around the world. But you know what? It's taken me 38 years to train Terry to do all the stuff she needs to do. I can't take another one on. I just can't fathom having two wives living in the same house together. If they're not chewing on me, they'd be chewing on each other. Because no two adult women can live in the same house and get along with each other for a long time. And y'all are shaking your heads and grinning and saying, yeah, if she trained you, you lie. She told us somebody not too long ago, she just barely got me to the point of civilized, let alone trained. And as we think about that, why would they pick that question to bother Jesus with? Why didn't they just give him a reason to give a long diatribe about resurrection so they could say, but there is no resurrection and you can't prove there's resurrection? And yes, he could, because he could go right over to Bethany and he could pick up his buddy Lazarus and they could jump in an Uber and they could drive back to Jerusalem. And they could get out, and they could get up on the podium and say, here he is, ladies and gentlemen, Lazarus, raised from the dead after he stinketh because he's been in the ground for too long. But they asked him a dumb question. And you know, most religious objections are dumb questions. Most of them have no common sense involved with them whatsoever, none. And Jesus didn't turn around and look at him and say, you're so stupid! He didn't. What did he say? Let's see. Jesus replied, watch this first answer. Your mistake is that you don't know the scriptures and you don't know the power of God. Ooh, you tell a religious person that. Go ahead, I dare you. These are the priestly class of people. One of them one day might be the new next high priest. And he says, you don't even know what the scriptures say. TikTok, let that set in. So lest we find ourselves in that predicament, what should we do? Know what the scriptures say. Correct? You never go into a fight without bullets for your gun. Correct? You can't fight a battle without bullets for your gun. When you're out in the world dealing with people who are trying to trip you up in your walk with God, you need bullets for your spiritual gun. Not so that you can wipe them out, but so that you can show them who God is and what He's really all about and what it means to be a follower of Christ. And you can cut through the BS and you can cut through the superstition and you can help them see that God is real and He's powerful and His word is true and it's never been proven to be wrong ever. Never. And you know, a lot of people say, well, archaeology proves God's word. Can I tell you what? There are some places they are never going to find. But here's what God does. Once in a while, when somebody's out digging in the dirt over there in Palestine or Babylon or someplace like that, they dig up something. And they found one about 25 years ago that had David's name written all over it, which proves King David was there. And Solomon's chariot house was found, and it was huge. They found those things, and they keep digging up all these old churches and things like that have been buried in 35, 40 feet of dirt because they just keep piling dirt on and building a new city on top of it. They found Jericho, where the walls fell down. Think about that. They found it. But just because they find those things, just because they found the Dead Sea Scrolls in the Wadi at Cumberland, do you think that proves that God's word is the same today as it was then? No, it doesn't prove it, but it's evidence that it hasn't changed, isn't it? We either faithfully believe that God is the God of who He says He is, or we don't. And the Sadducees have proven to Jesus, and He's pointed it out to them, that they don't know the Scriptures, and they don't believe in the power of God. They don't. I've met a lot of Christians who don't believe in miracles. But then I've met a lot of people who think everything should be a miracle. I've met a lot of people who don't believe that the Holy Ghost is still working in the world today, and I've seen others who try to go through every kind of machination you can to make it look like a circus show so that they can prove that the Holy Spirit exists. God's Word says the Holy Spirit convicts us of our sins, and the Bible says that God's Word teaches us in righteousness, and it rebukes us, and it corrects us, and it helps us understand. And Jesus is telling them, if you read God's Word, it'll straighten you out. It'll change your mind. It'll help you understand. That's exactly what God's Word says. But to say to somebody in this position, you don't know the Scriptures, I bet there was a guy who stood up and said, listen, I can quote the first five books of the Bible, word for word. What do you mean I don't know the Scriptures? Well, there's a difference between quoting it from your head and living it from your heart. Does that make sense? I mean, there are a lot of people out there who have all kinds of religious answers. And there are a lot of people out there who can pull a scripture out on you and use it to try to make you look bad, but it's always pulled out of context, and it's always used as a weapon, as a proof, instead of a something read in its own context so that you can understand it. We don't need proof texts. We don't need proof texts. We need to make God's Word a part of who we are so that we don't sin against Him. Is that correct? We need to hide God's Word in our hearts. We need to make it who we are. And to just be able to quote something verbatim. How many of you, when you were in school, whether it be high school or college, memorized something, and as soon as you answered the question on the test, you reached up and pulled the handle and and it went down, flushed it right there. And you don't even remember it anymore. How many of you can remember 10 phone numbers now? You know why you can't remember 10 phone numbers? Because it's programmed in your phone. All you got to do is push the button. How many of you remember when you had, well, I know people that used to have their phone hanging on the wall, and right there on the wall, they wrote the numbers right on the wall so they would know how to get a hold of whoever they need to get a hold of. We don't memorize anything anymore. And you should memorize for a purpose. The reason you memorize is to make you better. The reason you memorize is to make you stronger. And the reason you memorize God's word is to make you holier. Not holier than thou. These Pharisees and these Sadducees who were trying to trick Jesus, they were holier than thou. But who were they playing the holier than thou game with? God Himself. And there's nobody holier than God, is there? Nobody. That's the silly thing about this whole interchange. Jesus could have displayed who he was in front of them anytime he wanted to. He could have called 10,000 angels down and said, yep, this is Jesus. He's the Son of God. When he was on the cross, he could have called them down before they ever put him on there. He didn't have to go through all they went through. But you know what? God wants us to come to him because we desire a relationship with him. And sometimes our questions to God are pretty stupid questions. And sometimes the comments that we make, I'll believe in God if this, I'll believe in God if that, I'll give this to God if that. God is not interested in a conditional relationship with anybody, is he?
No.
He wants us. Jesus died for us. The whole that makes us who we are. Everything about us. That's why Jesus died. Because we are sinful to the core of our being, to our DNA, and he's the only answer for that. And these people thought they were holy. They thought they were righteous. They thought there was nothing in the world that anybody could say about them. He says, you don't know the scriptures and you don't know the power of God. For when the dead rise, they will neither marry nor be given in marriage. In this respect, they will be like the angels in heaven. Think about that for a minute. But now, as to whether the dead will be raised, haven't you ever read about this in the writings of Moses and the story of the burning bush? Long after Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had died, God said to Moses, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. So he is the God of the living, not the dead. You've made a serious error. Think about that. God is the God of life, not the God of death. They honored Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, all dead people. But if they're God's people, they're alive. And that's what Jesus was saying. You've made a grave error. You've made a serious mistake. And so, as we pack this up just a little bit, he refutes their ignorance. Jesus does. He refutes their ignorance. You don't know the scripture. God is the God of the living. Jesus wasn't intimidated by the religious experts. He wasn't. He met them head on and unapologetically. What normally happens when we get the opportunity to talk to somebody who has hard questions, or we have to answer somebody, what do we do? Pastor Ron, I need a lifeline. Well, Pastor Ron, will you talk to this person? Yeah, I guess, but how's that going to help you? Why don't we go talk to that person? And they're just like, well, you know, maybe it's not that important. But if you want to go talk to him, man, that'd be great. Why? Because we don't know the answers. And sad to say, I'm going to say this and it's going to hurt. We really don't. Honestly, truthfully, when it comes right down to not God, believe in the power of God. If we did, we would live with a sense of expectation that he was going to intervene in every day of our lives. Wouldn't we? If we really and truly believed in the power of God, and Jesus said to us, I'll be with you. And Peter said, always be willing to give a reason for the hope that lies within you. And Jesus said, unless you lay down your life for me, you don't belong to me. If we really believed in the power of God, every bit of that would be a part of what makes us who we are. Wouldn't it? Do we know the power of God? I do. God delivered me from some pretty awful things in my life. Awful. The latest of which was not being able to catch my breath. How many of you have seen God rescue from that just in the last couple months? You believe in the power of God? Yeah. But there was medicine involved. Who gave him the ability to make the medicine? God did. Who has a plan for your life? God does. Who's going to get you through whatever you face? God is. That's the way it works, guys. And if we don't know what God's Word says, and we don't believe that God's powerful and can get us through whatever we face, or whatever situation's going on, why are we wasting his time? Why? Being religious is not helpful. We continue to see that over and over and over again as Jesus is confronted by the religious people. Correct? And he just keeps putting it back on them. Let's not be Christian lawyers. That's an oxymoron anymore. Isn't it? That's an oxymoron. Let's not try to find loopholes. Let's believe in the power of God and live like God's empowered us to do everything that he said we could do. And let's live our lives in this dark world with our light shining on the hill instead of a candle under a basket, and especially during this time of the year. Find somebody and make a difference in their life for the kingdom and the cause of Jesus Christ. But you know what happens in this time of the year, Christmas time? Everybody, Christian and non-Christian alike, gets caught up in the gotta buy, because if I don't buy, I won't be happy, and if they're not happy, I won't be happy, and one thing that matters to me more than anything in my world is that I'm happy, until I see the bill in January, and then I'm not happy. Let's turn Christmas this year into telling people about Jesus, reading the stories with our kids over and over and over again so that they know the story, so that when they talk to somebody their age who doesn't know the story, they can help them understand the story. How about that? How about we live like we serve a powerful God? How about we serve God like we owe him everything that makes us who we are? Don't we? Let's not let any hang-up or anything stumble us at all. There is nothing greater than the power of God. And we have to remember this. Jesus said, with man, nothing is possible. But with God, all things are possible. Okay? You notice he didn't say all things are guaranteed? The only guarantee is that if we belong to him, one of these days we're going to be with him. And another guarantee is this. You're going to pay taxes. And another guarantee is you're going to have struggles in your life. But are you going to live by the power of God in your struggle? Or are you going to let the sadness stop you? Are you going to live with God in the midst of the storm that you're in? Or are you going to let your fear stop you? Those are the questions that we have to answer. And you know, some of you are saying, man, I'm so glad that we read that scripture today, because I ain't going to be married in heaven. I don't have to put up with you no more. That is not the point of this sermon. Not at all. Okay? Not at all. But the point of this is, Jesus dealt with people who said they knew a lot about God, but in fact really only knew the man-made traditions that went along to mask who God really was. We need to know the real God. We need to give everything that makes us who we are to him. And when you do that, your friendships will be better, your marriage will be better, your workplace will be better, your life will be better. When God is the most powerful person working through you, in you, and around you. Anybody believe that this morning?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Let's tell other people about Jesus. Go tell them about him. You know? And the thing that we think about this time of the year, the traditional churches are celebrating what they call Advent. How many of you grew up in a church where they celebrated Advent? First week Advent, second week Advent, third week Advent, fourth week Advent. We do that all year long, don't we? We don't just need to focus on something for 4 weeks. But part of Advent is the prophecies about Jesus. Part of it is the shepherds. Part of it is the angels. And then the fourth part of it is Jesus actually coming. And I have a green t-shirt that has this face on it. You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. Right? I am only grinchy about the commercialized part of Christmas. I love Jesus with everything that makes me feel okay. I thank God for the sacrifice that he made and for the fact that Jesus cared enough about us that he set aside his divine privilege and he put on human flesh and he came to this earth as the sweetest, most beautiful, most precious present that this earth has ever received. And he even came to his own, and his own rejected. And so many people this year, at Christmas time, and through years past and years future, even claiming to belong to Christ, they relegate him to another part of the story. He's the reason. He's the story. Our relationship with Him is the story. And as we surrender our lives to Christ, let's not leave Him out on Christmas. Deal? All right. Father God, we thank You for this day, for Your goodness and Your love, for Your mercy and Your forgiveness. Lord, I pray that as we live our lives for You, as we celebrate the fact that You came to this earth, Jesus, You came and You lived and You showed us the perfect example of humanity. And because You were sinless, You showed us the perfect example. But we're sinful and we struggle. And a lot of times we become lawyers like the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and we want to make things work to our benefit. We want things to go the way we want them to go. And Lord, we want to just call You when we need You, when we're in a crack we can't get out, or when we're not busy doing something else and it just happens to cross our mind that it's been a while since we've prayed, and who knows, Lord knows, last time we picked up our Bible and read it. Let's read those stories. Let's understand. Let's see how amazing You are. And God, I pray that as we finish up this Christmas season in the next couple weeks and we move into the new year, that we would be so energized for the kingdom and the cause of Christ that nobody could shut us up. And we wouldn't have answers for the religious detractors and the religious people who would try to tell us that what we believe is incorrect because they only know their traditions. God, help us to be witnesses in this dark world. Help us to maintain the integrity of the story. Help us to maintain the truth that it's not about presence. It's about Your presence in this earth that gives us hope and fulfills us and brings us joy. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing. We'll sing the last song. Looking forward to Christmas. Remember what I said? The angel told him to name Him Jesus, but He would also be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. And this song's been around for a while. It's an old song. It's called O Come, Emmanuel.
Israel, O come, Thou wisdom from
is the Prince of Peace, isn't he?
Amen.
And all nations will be ruled by him for a period of time. We're going to talk about that as we do our Bible study on Revelation, that there's coming a time when Jesus is going to be on the earth ruling. And everybody's going to have to bow to his will, and he's going to rule with the wrath of a rod of iron, not something that can easily be bent. So one of these days he's coming back. Don't split the sky open. We're going to be a part of what he wants for eternity. And that's the blessing that we have. So, you know, we can sing about him being born, but he's already been born, correct? So now we're going to sing about him coming back again. That's O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. We have a few other announcements. I'm not sure we have slides for those this morning. We have been working now.
Okay, so this evening there is youth group from 6 to 8 p.m. Come and join if you have a child, fifth grade and up, Justin, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And there is child care for the younger ones if you need to bring them along as well. It's a Bible study. Next slide, Travis. Bible study this evening, Debunking Doomsday Myths. That's with Pastor Ron that's over in the fellowship hall. That's from 6 p.m. to 7:30 or, you know, a little after. Thanks. The Giving Tree. Gary, you want to talk about that?
Yes, we do have a family that we are adopting for Christmas. The Christmas tree in the back corner is loaded with ornaments. If you have a question, if we weren't detailed enough on the ornament for you, ask questions to Rachel, or myself, I guess. And anyway, and I would like those back. I need those back next Sunday. So just bring them with you. Please, if you wrap them, that would be wonderful. And please keep the tag with that gift so that we know, and let Rachel know what you took, I guess. Right? No, we don't want that? Okay. Just take the gift.
Yeah,
and
put
the
name on it, just buy it and wrap it.
But keep the tag with it so that we know who it goes for. Because there is a boy and a girl, fourth grade girl, fifth grade boy, and single mom. So,
And if anybody's got a, Tracy sent out an email, did anybody answer that you know yet about the dresser? If anybody has a small chest of drawers that you need to get rid of that's just kind of sitting around, we needed two, we got one already. We need a small chest of drawers because these kids don't even have a dresser to put their clothes in.
And
so,
a floor, well, any kind of lamp, table lamp or a floor lamp, yes, she says their living room is really dark.
So what did we talk about a minute ago? Reach out and help somebody if you can, if you would. Also, next week, we have our annual business meeting where we talk about the budget, which shouldn't take very long. That'll be right after church. And then we're going to have a dinner after that, kind of a celebration dinner for the holidays for everybody in the church. Sign-up sheets in the back. There are a few people signed up. If you're coming, we need to know because we're going to be providing the meat and everybody's bringing the sides. So, sign up so we know what's going on so that we can plan accordingly. Anything else?
One more time. There's a blood drive coming up in January. I hope I have the date right. Tuesday, January 11th. Is that correct, Rachel? Yes. Oh, there you are. I'm looking back there for you. So there'll be more information to come out prior to that because we want to register online and let them know.
Yeah, it's only 4 weeks away, so don't give your blood to anybody else.
Okay, also, there's one last thing. Thursday night, all the kids that are going to be in the program next Sunday need to be here to practice at what time?
6:15-ish.
Mm-hmm. So if your kids are singing and being a part of Sunday's Christmas thing for the kids that they're going to do during the service, have them here on time so we can practice. Because we old people have to get our worship practice in after that. You know, when it gets too late, we don't do very well. So, but yes, we'd love to have the kids. We need to have the kids here so they can practice on the stage and where they're going to be so they know what's going on so it's not a surprise. All right, thank you very much. God bless and have a great week.